right now we are in the presence of a legend. Everyone, can I please welcome Mr. Raphael Saadiq? How are you, sir?
Good.
Down to the very root of things, your name. As a child, you were named Charles Ray Williams. Right. How did we get to Raphael Saadiq?
Just created him one day. I just said, you know, the name changed, and I went real P. Diddy on him. I just said, it's time to, you know, rock something else right now.
Yeah, and he's changed it quite a few times. But you're going to stick with Raphael Saadiq, aren't you?
Yeah.
Okay, let's fast forward to today. You're going to see the Stone Rolling. Mm-hmm. For those who are not really with it, what does that mean? What's
this about? Stone rolling just means, you know, I'm doing it. It's like a play on words, really, throwing dice. When I named this album Stone Rolling, yeah. But what I meant from the span of my whole career, mm-hmm. that I've always, you know, taken chances,
okay.
you know, and went down roads to less travel and, you know, my whole career, so I decided to name the album that,
okay.
relating to my whole career.
This time around, where have you decided to go and meet, like, musically?
I just wanted to dig a little deeper than I did, you know, last time. You know, every record you should try to, like, you know, mm-hmm. not to try to be, you know, different just for the sake of being different, mm-hmm. but just to, you know, if it's a lot more to you, you just want to show people different levels of what you can do. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, if you have to go out and perform it, you want to have fun when you're doing it. You know? And it's about that for me too, you know, it's just not about going to perform. I like to take my audience somewhere every time.
Okay, so Tony, major success began with you in that group, but you're pretty amazing by yourself, so why did you start off in a group?
Well, you know, I was in the group with one of my really good friends and my brother, you know, two amazing musicians, you know, so, I mean, what better guys to start with?
And you're in another successful group, Lucy Pearl, with Don Robinson, who was previously in Vogue. Okay, she left in Vogue, then she left Lucy Pearl again. Did you ever just think, make up your mind then?
No, I don't know what's, you know, everybody has their own road. They have to travel, you have to let people, you know, take their route. Mm-hmm. You can't really stop them, you know. Hopefully she reaches the destination, wherever she's trying to get.
Are you still in contact now?
No.
Some of our viewers have actually written and asked us, would you ever get back? Would you ever want to put Lucy Pearl back together again?
Oh, no.
So you're like a headmaster in the School of Producers. You've produced for so many people, TLC, Mary J. Blige, John Legend, even did a remix for Tupac. Looking back, is there anyone you think you missed out? Is there anyone you'd like to work with now?
No, it's just all, if you work with them, it's supposed to be. If you don't, you're not supposed to.
Okay. And you collaborated with Rick Ross on the track All Around the World.
Mm-hmm.
You guys friends, you guys hang. How did the collaboration come about?
He was a fan, you know, from, you know, I've been doing it before him, and when I saw, you know, him too, I was a fan also. You know, he's a pretty incredible dude. To come up and be that, you know, important now, it's really hard to do. So he had called me and he sent me something. He actually came from Miami.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think he was in Vegas working on a record, he flew to LA.
Okay.
And he brought a track and we just wrote to it right there and just sang it.
Yeah. And since you say you were a fan as well, I wonder if you heard about the correctional officer story. I mean, he's one of our most notorious rappers right now. Are you surprised that he still managed to be such a credible rapper after, you know, what happened with the coming out story of being a correctional officer?
No, it's better that he was a correction officer than, like, you know, a murderer. I mean, we got to kind of mixed up in the industry.
Yeah, it's quite true. I mean, I guess some of his fans would be upset because he betrayed the image that, you know, we don't miss him, that side of the law. But then again, I guess you're right. You should see it the other way.
Yeah, we got it mixed up.
Yeah.
We got to get that right.
Let's take a breath a bit now, if you don't mind me asking. You came from a family of 14 siblings, but your childhood was marred with a bit of tragedy. Okay. How are you able to go from something like that you faced back then to such a successful career? Like, did you internalize the feeling? Did your music help you?
Yeah, I think I just sort of, I channeled it, you know. Because first of all, I was kind of young when some of the first things happened, and I had time to, like, you know, to figure it out and, you know, look at other families who might have went through it, and you know, just one of those things. I think I just took it all in and just, you know, just made positive so other people could probably see, like, you know, if you kind of go through these things, you can, you can not get past it, you never get past it, but you can take it and make positive.
So do you feel it inspires your music up until today?
Oh yeah, it does. I mean, just like to be the best you can be, you know what I mean? As a performer, as a writer, producer, you know, you can't take for granted the days that you're around and you're making music, or you're just going to work every day, whatever your profession is, you know, whatever it is, you should take serious and be on time for it and just make it happen.
Recommendable. So you were nominated for a heckload of Grammys. Do you ever get fed up with all the nominations?
No. You don't get fed up with it. It's an honor to be honored by the Academy. But at the same time, you know, I'm not into awards like that.
Okay, that's what I wanted to ask you.
Yeah, but
some people, it's not that important. I mean, some people say it's not important, but do you actually, when you say it's not important, do you actually mean it?
No, I actually mean it. I think that the rewards are, for me, or when you make the music, when it's coming out of speakers back at you, I think that's more of a reward for me. But now, for people who, you know, support you for so long, it's good for them to see you on the Grammy and the TV, because they're like, you know, well, we've been supporting them, feel like the Academy should too.
Should you do, of course, Okay, all right, rounding off, we have a quick game for you. I mean, you've achieved so much. We want to ask what have been your worst moments. So we have 5 questions for you, very quick, and they all begin with, what's the worst? There's the word they begin with, and you have to answer. So, let's go. You ready? Good. Right. What's the worst song you've ever recorded?
It's called One Night Stand. It was the Tony's first song. It never came out.
Okay, why?
Why didn't it come out?
Yeah.
Well, it came out, but it was an independent label, so people never heard it.
Oh, okay. What's the worst thing someone can do to get to your nerves?
Call me, and then call me right after with a block number.
What's the worst investment you've ever made?
I bought a Hummer one time. So it's the stupidest car you ever bought.
Okay, right, we'll leave it at that. Thank you very much for talking to us. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.